Yes, we are. Okay guys, welcome back to part 2. So today it's a little bit different. We have a remote speaker. So PJ is from Engine Yard, who is a sponsor of the last few meetups for our food. So a big thank you to Engine Yard. And today PJ actually woke up really early because he's not on the Singapore time zone. So a huge thank you to him. Without further ado, I'll let him take over. So you can't really see him, he's like an invisible speaker, but you should be able to hear him. PJ, could you try speaking? Saying something?
Yeah, can everybody hear me okay?
Yes!
Alright, cool. It's all yours, PJ.
Alright, thank you very much, Winston. Talking to Winston a little bit ago, and we talked about what I was going to talk about, and I decided I was going to do a talk about Sinatra versus Rails. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through different aspects of both of them and talk about when it's appropriate to use them and when it's maybe better to use one instead of the other. So as Winston said, I'm PJ. I go by Splenic on Twitter, and my email is pj@engineering.com, so it's pretty easy to remember. So let's go ahead and get started. So what is Rails? We'll start with what Rails is. It's MVC-based web framework created in 2004 by DHH. To make Ruby have a web presence. The whole idea was to get Ruby on the web. And the idea is that it would make developers happier, since Ruby was designed to make developers happy, getting them on the web would make them happier and it would be more efficient. For the record, I think that what David did was absolutely amazing. I begrudge him absolutely nothing because frankly, without Rails, I wouldn't be here today. It's how I got started in Ruby in the first place, so Rails, you know, is an amazing thing that's come a long way since it first came out in 2004. So that brings us to Sinatra. What's Sinatra? Well, Sinatra came around a little bit later. It came around in 2007. It was originally developed by Blake Mizrani, and it's currently maintained by Constantine Haas. It kind of took the opposite approach to Rails in that the only thing it has the basics of what you need to put an application up on the web. There's no magic, there's no unicorns. It's just simple, elegant routes to put your application up on the web as with a DSL over RAC. So, I mean, very simple, very easy to use, very sparse, and obviously not quite as popular as Rails because not as many people know about it. So let's take a look at how easy it is to get started in both of these things. We'll start with Rails. Part of the appeal of Rails is that it's so easy to use. Chances are that if you're already familiar enough with Ruby, you know how to do a gem install. So Rails is the same thing. You just grab the version of Rails you want and you go for it. Within minutes, you have this page up that I'm showing right here, this welcome aboard. We've all seen this page. If you've ever built anything in Rails, you've seen this page. Sometimes you get sick of seeing this page. But within minutes, you have this page up, and you feel as though something's been accomplished. You've done it. So getting started in Rails seems really easy. It's really simple, but there's some caveats. You're started, but from there, you need to acquire a bit of knowledge before moving forward. The more experience you get with Rails, the more likely you are to avoid some of these startup, you know, failures and these pitfalls. But no matter what, you start to see some of these issues creeping up, no matter how often you've used Rails or how familiar you are with it. All these little pretty red errors start popping up all over the place. So even the best veterans in the world can get caught. So you have to pay attention. But once you get over that initial startup, you get to iron out some of the kinks, and you can be very successful with a Rails app. I mean, if that wasn't possible, no one would use it. And people are using it all over the place for some of the biggest applications imaginable, including, you know, even our own engineer runs on Rails. So the keys here are, with Rails, it's easier to get started with database integration. It's easier for managing larger scale application needs, running an enterprise level app with just a little bit of, you know, a little bit of code. And there's plenty of resources for getting started. Part of the beauty of Rails is the amount of documentation and literature available on how to get started. This is just a few like quick URLs on getting started in Rails. There's literally thousands of books and tutorials and online resources, all kinds of things, just to learn Rails. So this list is barely inclusive. This is just some of the things that like immediately popped into my head when I started to think about doing this talk. So there are so many more resources. And the question is, well, how does that really compare to Sinatra? So let's take a look at Sinatra real quick. So getting started with Sinatra, beginning's not so much different when you compare it to Rails. It's really all about the gems. So again, just, you know, there's fewer dependencies when you download Sinatra. It downloads really quickly. You install the gem, you're ready to go. So I guess that's a plus for Sinatra right off the bat, is it's not quite as time-consuming as getting started in Rails as far as just the setup. Of course, in the same way, if you aren't careful when you're getting started, you can end up with errors. In fairness, Sinatra's errors are a bit more descriptive, and generally, they get you moving in the right direction compared to Rails, which are kind of esoteric and sometimes misleading. And they give you this huge trail of code, this huge stack trace that you don't even know where you're going. In Sinatra, they give you a little bit more direction, it's a little bit more specific, and therefore it's a little bit easier to look around and figure out exactly what it is you're looking to fix. After the start, of course, in the same way, if you aren't careful, when you're getting started, you end up with errors. But once those first roadblocks are overcome, it gets easier to use Sinatra. In the same way that getting familiar with Rails makes it easier. So a lot of this is familiarity. If you're used to using Rails, you're used to using Rails, and you're probably going to go back to it. If you're used to using Sinatra, you're probably going to continually go to that. So once those first roadblocks are over, you start using Sinatra the same way it's as easy as getting familiar with Rails. The interesting difference is probably time, though. Sinatra is simpler. It takes significantly less time to get used to. I would even argue that Sinatra is a good way to get started in order to understand routes, which is another part of Rails. So what's Sinatra for then? Sinatra really is for simplicity. It's for building things super quickly, for building things that are fairly straightforward, not your super complicated enterprise-y type applications. You know, when you look at an application like Groupon, which seems simple when you look at it, in the background there's just a ton of stuff going on that we don't even know about. So Sinatra, again, to be fair, it's going to have fewer resources. There's less documentation when it comes to getting started in Sinatra when compared to Rails. And the reason for this is due to a lot of it's the press. And in many ways, because we're the community using these things, we are the press. Rails simply gets more attention because Rails has been around for longer and more people talk about it. Whether it's, you know, the drama of things that DHH says, or, you know, the craziness of things that are going on in the Rails community or the Ruby community, people talk about Rails. And you almost always hear when people say, Ruby, oh, you do Ruby on Rails. No, not necessarily. There's so many other things out there. There's a lot more to Ruby than Rails, but the two things have become utterly linked, just 100% linked. Maybe with a bit of diligence, getting Sinatra kicked off wouldn't be that hard to get it to that level where when we think of Ruby, we also think of Sinatra, and Rails isn't the only thing we think about. So let's take a look at what's the difference between these two things. It seems that when we compare the bare basics, that they're pretty much the same, right? I mean, sure, Sinatra is a bit more straightforward and Rails has a bit more magic to make things easier, but are we still getting our Ruby stuff on the web? Is there really a need to choose? That's kind of a huge question. Hopefully, when we look at this, we'll see that, yeah, there's definitely a need to choose, and there's a reason why these two things are actually quite different. So the first thing we're going to look at is the API. When it comes to tapping into the power of an API and bringing information from an API to something else, Sinatra has the upper hand. Because it's simple, Sinatra has the flexibility to focus on the main task, which is pulling the information needed. The information we have here to start off with is from the meetup.com API. And what it does is, this is just one single query It pushes it back in JSON. You can do it in different modes, but it pushes it back in JSON. And what you're looking at is actually the metadata, the information from my meetup group, the Western New York Rooming Group. And you can see just basic simple information. We're called the Western New York Rooming Group. We live in Buffalo, New York. For those of you who don't know, that's very close to Niagara Falls. We focus on Rubius. We have an IT. This meetup group was created by Wayne Seguin, who created RBM. So you guys probably know that name. Little stuff like that, all this information that just kind of all comes in from this JSON format. And Sinatra takes that, really simple, and parses it. This is code from a little internal app that I'm doing. Oh, I was supposed to take that key up. That was clever. Don't use my personal key for meetup.com. You might pull a bunch of information, blah, blah, blah. Anyway, seriously though, this is a query that I use to get all of the Ruby meetup groups around the world. And I'm using it to display real simply. We just wanted to see how many meetup groups we can pull, what information can we pull from meetup.com? How many different meetups in each of the different key focus areas were we looking at? And then how can we reach out to these people and say, let's get involved with them? So really quickly, I put this together. You have your route at the top, which is just, get Ruby, do, it has, type, params type. It pulls the API result, which is JSON. We parse the JSON. We kick that back out to a view. And does this for a bunch of different, does it for Ruby, PHP, all the different meetups that we focus on. So this is all the code that's needed in Sinatra to pull the information for the top 200 meetups, according to meetup.com. The reason why I say top 200 is because for some reason meetup.com limits you at pulling the first 200 groups. For smaller groups, like the node, not as many node meetups, so we don't get a full 200, we get every node meetup that's on meetup.com. But like I said, the previous slide was JSON returned by the API. It's easy to just take this information, display it, manipulate it, whatever you need to do. When it comes time to move it into a database, though, that's when things start to get kind of railsy. More often than not, when working with Sinatra and trying to inject information into a database, the first few suggestions you try to implement, will tell you to try to implement directly. And this is where the lines start to blur, and maybe you should wonder if Sinatra's the right answer. If you're just pulling an API, displaying that data, maybe making a graph out of it, something like that, simple manipulation, really easy to do. When you start looking at pulling it into a database, eyebrows start to raise. And like I said, you can literally Google like Sinatra with database or something along those lines. Google that and your first five responses are going to be implement Active Record. And then, as we all know, Active Record is already part of Rails. So to add to that, Rails does have an API controller that can handle APIs and abstract them away from the application controller so they won't interfere with the function of the main application. But if the only function of the application is to pull from the API, this is total overkill. Like, why do you need the heaviness and the top heaviness of Rails to just pull information from an API? If that's all you're doing. So it's too much overhead for a simple application. Rails is too much for just API graphs. So what about when we start looking at the full-on application? When it comes to building a full-scale application, Rails is going to be more likely the better choice. Rails is large. But that also means it's more robust and can handle a lot of things that you'll need to focus on when you're building an application that needs to have things like, a database and various background jobs. And what you're looking at is, you're having more end users, you're working with more people. So when we consider scale, Rails is going to far outstrip Sinatra. As we grow our application, assuming we started it in Sinatra, we'll see that as the number of users and endpoints grows to something beyond 5 or 10, the more we're implementing parts of Rails and Sinatra in order to keep up. So let's assume that we started this application and we did it in Sinatra. And we started, it was like, your brother and your friend from school were using it, and that was all you had to worry about. But then they started talking to people, and they started talking to people, and eventually, 10 to 15 people started using it, and you see that you're getting absolutely slammed. Well, maybe it's time to move from Sinatra to Rails because you're going to start processing more information. So once that starts happening, once the Sinatra app is difficult to manage, it's time to rebuild it in Rails. And it may be obvious over time, but timing is crucial. And knowing your application, having intimate knowledge of your application, will help you determine when this switch needs to take place. Now, if you look at these two diagrams up here, I know that the one on the left is not an actual program diagram, but I wanted it for the simplicity of it. Like, this is kind of, a lot of times, how I think of my Sinatra apps. Like, super simple. I have a simple model, and it kicks out to a simple view. And it's just, you know, a few lines of code. Not a big deal. It's the behavior that I want. No big whoop. And then sometimes when I think about some of the Rails apps I've developed, it's exactly like this one on the right here, where it's literally like, my God, there's parts I don't understand. And then, you know, here we're at the web, you got Apache server, there's a giant snake eating something. I don't know exactly what that is, but whatever, I need it, it's necessary. Like, this is how Rails apps often look after a little bit of time. So that's when you have to start looking at what's the right thing to do. And even there's a possibility that maybe Rails isn't the right answer, you need to move to something different. But we'll talk about that later. So the key here is, beyond complexity, we always need to focus on performance. Availability, latency, and scalability are the cornerstone of whether or not we have customers using our application at the end of the day. Whether it's a money-making venture or an open source gift to the community, if our app has no users, it is useless. We have to focus on the ability of having these things ready to go for our customer. And that's something that I think that, you know, especially we at Engineer try to focus on all the time. We talk about 24/7 uptime, and that's what end users want. They want the ability to always be able to use an application. They don't want to think about whatever went into it. They just want to make sure it's always there. Performance is also an issue that comes down to the size of the application. If you're running a Sinatra application, but it starts to grow, you're going to start to see dips in performance. Before it grows, Sinatra is like unbelievably fast. With Rails, there's many ways to offload certain aspects of an application to lighten the load to improve performance. Things like database indexing, creating ETLs, background jobs for the application, things that just make it much easier to implement in Rails. Therefore, you can get a boost to performance as the application begins to grow. You'll probably never see it as fast as it was in Sinatra, but you can see it to a point that it only dips so far. Things only get so much slower, and you can control that with various other things, you know, tossing stuff out to utility instances, not keeping everything on the same server. There's different things you can do to kind of tweak Rails to get better performance. It's never going to be as good as Sinatra, but you can get it to be pretty darn good. So who wins? In this situation, there's really no clear winner. Rails and Sinatra each speak to a specific need. As a developer, your job is to see the needs of the code now and see the needs of the users over time. So we look at what we currently have, and then we look at what we're going to need. Part of your job, and maybe it's not your job as a developer, maybe it's your project manager's job, but someone in your organization, it's their specific job to see what's going on now and see where things are going to go to make sure that you're serving your customers as best as possible. The more familiar you are with both Rails and Sinatra, the better off you're going to be to make that decision as far as what needs to be done now, what needs to be done moving forward. So, when do you use Rails? When you're looking at larger scale applications, when you're looking at professional sites, a lot of times I know people that use Sinatra in development only, and as soon as they're ready to go full scale, they will convert the Sinatra app to Rails. It does come off as being a little bit more polished. Whenever you have an expectancy of many users and more than 10 to 15 endpoints, you're going to want to use Rails. Rails is for the big jobs. It's for the heavy cleanup. It's for the big money-making killer app idea that you have that's going to make you a millionaire and move to Silicon Valley and live on the beach. When do you use Sinatra? small projects, APIs, pet projects, little things in Ruby that you want to do that aren't exactly huge. Something that's, you know, for a small number of users that you're not going to be too concerned about performance if you have lots of users and endpoints. Sinatra is great. It's fast. It gets you moved quickly. Even faster than Rails, because you don't have to worry about things like database setup right off the bat or anything like that. You can just go and write things in Sinatra and have something, you know, capable of running what you want it to run in 5 to 10 minutes. So Sinatra is great for the quick startup. However, when it's time to start thinking about production and end users, you want to move to Rails. So just for the sake of argument, there are other alternatives out there. Cuba is something that I've been playing around with for a bit now. It's very much like Sinatra, almost just like Sinatra, but a little bit more lightweight. It's based on routes. Padrino, also very similar to Sinatra. It's kind of like a step between Sinatra and Rails. It's a little heavier than Sinatra, but it works in the same way. Cramp, gin, salad, camping, all great alternatives. There's one that I didn't include called Rails Natra, which is pretty much the perfect middle ground between Rails and Sinatra. So when we talk about taking those steps of, you know, I have a Sinatra application, it's working great, but it's time for me to move forward into something bigger, maybe Rails Natra can be that middle step. So, I mean, this is all to say Rails and Sinatra aren't your only options. There are plenty of full and micro frameworks out there for the average Ruby developer. Most, but not all of them are Rack-based. Sinatra is Rack-based. Most infrastructure and platform providers work with Rack, so it's been a part of the Ruby infrastructure for so long. So take a look and figure out what's the right tool for your application. And again, that's gonna change over time, but that's just another part of iterative development. So Rails and Sinatra all have their purpose. These all have their purpose. You have to find what fits your application, what fits your project, and what's right for you. So with that, that seemed to go really fast. Do you guys have any questions?
Do we have any questions? You guys can ask about anything about Engine Yard as well. Anything? No?
Wow. I must have really nailed it.
We have one question.
Okay.
Can you hear me? No.
Never mind, I'll repeat the question. Yeah.
So this is not related to Sinatra versus Rails at all, but something I noticed that Engine Yard pushed out recently is a data mapper to active record migration gem. So I was wondering if you have any idea of like this, like were you guys using data mapper in production in a large scale fashion? And if yes, like have you guys transitioned to Active Record and how was that process?
PJ, do you hear that?
Yeah. I'm not sure if I'm the best person to answer that question. Mostly because I don't work directly with the development team. But I know that we were using DataMapper, and I do know that there was a move to go to Active Record. There's also a bunch of stuff going on with our user interface and how we're using Rails. So I'm not sure how to correctly answer that question. But I know that at this point in time, everything's being taken into consideration as we move towards the new version, the next gen version of Engineer, which I can't talk that much about yet. So ask me that question again in like 3 months.
Sure.
Are there any plans for Engine Yard to have data centers closer to Singapore in the near future?
Yes, I will say that we are working with all of our infrastructure providers we're working to add more infrastructure providers, and B, we are working to add more centers for each of the infrastructure providers that we work with. So I know that the whole of Asia Pacific is something that we've been trying to work with. We started with working with the AWS centers that are in Australia, And that was our first jump into the whole Asia Pacific idea. So yes, we are planning on getting more data centers close to Singapore. I know that because we actually have a bunch of guys who work in the Philippines, and they're pushing for all the data centers in the Philippines first. So we'll see which one, which ball of wax gets caught first. But yes, it's something we definitely are working on.
Okay. Any other questions from the audience? Nope. I'll put up PJ's email later on the Google group or something, so that if you have questions, you can email PJ privately.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm always open to questions. I'm available much of the time. Like, I'll answer things after hours. So the only thing I have left to say, I have to say I do work at EngineYard. I have to include this slide. We do Ruby, PHP, Node.js, Java, platform as a service, high performance, open access, best support in the world. If you have any questions, we have a free trial, so check it out. And that's my information there, so if anybody needs to take it down before Winston gets it up, feel free to get in touch with me.
All right. Thank you so much, PJ.
Thank you. You guys have a good rest of your day.
Yeah, you too. I'll speak to you soon.
All right, thanks. Bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.